here this morning with all of you, or this afternoon, your time. Thank you so much, Dr. Zaghloul. As usual, the gentleman, and it's always an honor to be with you and working with you. You know, Dr. Hatem, basically, his impact to science and technology is way, way, way above what I've ever tried to do. So I'm very humbled with those kind words, Dr. Hatem. A quick brief about myself. I'm Hussam. I am actually a Canadian of Egyptian origin. I was born in Africa, and actually I was also raised in Africa. To be specific, I actually grew up in Nigeria. And when we were living there in Nigeria, we had a problem with water. I mean, I'm basically speaking about the 60s now, right? I mean, we're speaking about mid-60s. So in a nutshell, the problem we had is that we had to go to take the water out of the well before we could drink it. We had to boil it and do a lot of stuff to clean it out. And when my parents moved to the UK, where I got my master's in computer science, and here's my cat, by the way, as I told you, basically we went in and had an amazing experience. In fact, the very first amazing experience to me was opening the tap to get clean water. And that is the vision that I always had for internet security, is that this cable that I'm showing you here, that that we're having in one's hands, should provide you with nothing but clean traffic. And unfortunately, here we are in 2021. You know, we've been having internet, we've been speaking about internet, and we've been having internet for at least the last 40 years. And until this moment in time, that's not possible. That is not possible, surprisingly, right? We're having traffic that's not clean. We're having traffic that's coming to us with malware, and that's a big issue. So since actually nearly 10 years ago, after my fourth startup, I decided that we basically have to solve this problem with my team, and we started on that problem. So today, even though you'd be hearing me speak a bit about our technology and so on, my focus is going to be on the science behind it and how we're trying to solve this problem. So cloud security is something that I'm very interested in. And please do notice, I'm not speaking about internet security. Frankly speaking, internet is going to be nothing more than the pipe or the transport. What we're focused on right now is cloud security, because everything is connected to the cloud. So with that background, I'm going to start speaking to you about the problem as we see it, and then show you why the problem is huge. I'm not going to speak about my company. I'm just going to quickly go and speak about the problem here quickly. So I'm going to show you a problem that happens day in and day out. And the problem is simply, you could be having this person, and he is seated in his own environment, and from there, what's happening is he could get a link, and the link could be any link. Like, for example, he could be going over the web. He could end up with a message in his mailbox containing a link, and the guy basically goes in and clicks on the link. And even though typically, the way we secure our environment is by having firewalls and sandboxes and endpoint security and so on, the problem is all of these are not enough. And what could happen here, the guy saw that he's going to get a Netflix account. He clicks on that link. And what's happening in the background is that it is actually encrypting the poor guy's hard disk. And poof, now he is having a problem. Why is that? Because his hardware or his laptop has been completely ransomed. This is something that happens very often, very frequently, day in, day out, regardless of where you are in the world, right? It doesn't have to be only in certain countries. It happens everywhere. And it's a bad problem when it happens, because now you have your computer completely ransomed and you don't know, right, what to do from there. And the reason this is failing and this is falling is because we do have security products that are not sufficient. And the reason they're not sufficient is because we rely on signatures. And what does signature mean? It means that I've had to see the malware before I can to detect it. That's one thing. And even then, we have something called sandbox. And I'm going to talk to you more about that if that's not clear. And sandboxes basically are nothing more than emulation environment, and the result of which that they need time. And as a result of that, here you are. You have this problem. This guy's machine has been completely ransomed, meaning that someone has encrypted it for him, and then they're going to basically ask for money, and usually they ask for money in bitcoins. And when this happens, it's a big problem because A, you now have to go into trying to figure out what truly happened. That's one thing. What truly happened? How did this malware go into your network? That's one thing. And then you have to find also, where did the malware move from there? Did it move to another machine in your network? Did it move and go somewhere else, right? And as well, you have to figure out, did it just ransom the machine, meaning that did it just lock it up? Or did it do more than that? And by more than that, I mean it could have stolen data out of your environment. And that is the bigger problem, because frankly speaking, if it ransomed your machine, then, and that was it, then you might start thinking of just bringing up another backup or doing something about it. And you might be willing to live with that consequence. But if it stole data and it now has the data of your customers, of your employees, even your own personal data, then that is quite severe, and you'd have to start thinking of what to do next. In some cases, unfortunately, companies can decide and elect to pay the ransom, even though now here in North America, it's against the law. You cannot do this any further. In fact, the reason we have our lawmakers saying that's not going to be allowed is because these guys are becoming extremely, extremely rich, and there's no end to it. Now, the vision we always had in my company, and that's what we're doing now using artificial intelligence, and I'm going to talk to you about how we do it, is that we can stop these malwares in real time, even if they're unknown. And the question becomes how. And that is basically the contribution to the science that we do. And here it is, by the way, the experience you would get when you implement my product is that we are able to stop these unknown malwares in real time. So that is basically how I'm going to take you through this journey this morning. That's how I'm going to take you through how we did it and how we do it and how are we pushing the frontiers of the science to be able to protect ourselves better. Because frankly speaking, science without application is useless, right? You don't want that. You want to have science that solves problems, that actually adds to our life. So the question becomes, how do we do it? And I'm going to tell you in a nutshell very quickly, and then I'm going to take you through the actual technology and then the different types of AI techniques we had to consider in doing so. I'm going to keep this at what we can call as the Reader's Digest level, but I can always delve into if you want it, and I can even go further than that if you wish. So what we do basically is that we use artificial intelligence techniques. However, we do not use behavioral AI because behavioral AI takes time. We use what's called the static code analysis techniques, and I'm going to tell you more about that. And as a result of that, as the code of the malware is going through the network, we intercept it, we're able to scan it, and we're able to apply our machine learning techniques in real time and stop it. And by the way, for the record, we're the only ones in the world that were able to do that right now. But then, what is ransomware, and why is it such a big deal? In fact, right now, it is such a huge deal because no one is safe. Really, no one is safe, and it is such a compounded problem that, like in the whole of the world last year, this problem costed us around $3.86 million a company when it happens. So the average cost for a company that pays that was that. And in fact, I did a quick research when Dr. Hatton told me that I'm going to be speaking to you this morning. And I actually did find that Pakistan was also badly hit. And there are at least 3 or 4 cases in which your power grid was crippled, banks were crippled, SWIFT information was stolen, people's credit cards are available on the internet, so it also hits everyone. No one is safe here. And I think in your case, right, it was actually quite severe as well. So the average cost of 3.86 million is sort of like what we have, the statistical average. And in the United States, it's even more, because actually here in Canada, United States, we are a litigious society, meaning that, you know, I can sue you because I have lawyers, right? That's how it works. Now, we have seen some estimates, and the estimates is that to date, you know, ransomware has costed us financially as humanity over $11 billion, and it's continuously adding up. Now, the thing that's really worrisome and I really, really concerned is going further is not that just ransomware is attacking companies, but it's attacking governments. And that actually means that suddenly you can have these attackers, forcing governments to do things they shouldn't do and impacting now the whole population and can do so badly. Now, ransomware is a huge problem because in addition to it impacting us all through, we are mostly working from home. I mean, COVID has hit us badly. I don't know what's happening in Pakistan, but here in Canada, for example, in the province I'm living, we're now through the fourth wave. And it's quite miserable, I have to say, because most of us still have to work from home. And from this perspective, when you work from home, you're using your own PCs, you're using your own machines, you're using your home network, you don't have the protections of the enterprise, so it's getting worse and worse. Now, the problem, in my humble opinion, is not known malware. The problem is unknown malware. And what do I mean by that? I mean that, think of it, if I'm coming to your airport in Karachi or Islamabad or whatever have you, and if I'm trying to come into your country, the first thing you do is that you scan my passport. And when you're scanning my passport, what you're doing effectively is that you're matching my records against records you have. And if I happen to be a bad guy, you're not allow me. So that's exactly what we do in security, is that we try as much as possible to have signatures. And signatures means that we try to have a collection or a database of all malwares we have seen, and then your perimeters, your security systems at the perimeter tries to scan it, and if it sees something there, it stops it. Now, the problem is new malware is becoming really a commodity, meaning that I can hire people out there to start writing malware so that I can cripple your defenses. And at that time, it will be completely brand new, or it could be tailored for you that you will not be able to stop it because there is no signature for it. And hence, new malware is the problem. And we can see in last two quarters of 2020, the first two quarters of 2020, get this, we had over 50 to 60 million new pieces of malware written, which means that chances that you are going to get hit by something that has not been seen before is extremely, extremely high. To put it in perspective, this is the global amount of malware we have, nearly 1.2 billion. So as you can see, right, 60 million is a staggering big number. And then COVID. Let's speak about COVID. COVID basically came in and it's still with us, and we're still trying to shrug it off, and it's not happening yet. But we're having a lot of attacks related to COVID, meaning that there are attacks that are happening to you because you have to work from home. There are attacks that are happening to your enterprise because of the new nature of doing business. But also in addition to that, there could be files that, you know, would try to trick you into certain things. Now, what do malwares do? And we can see very quickly here, the biggest goal of malware is exploits, meaning that they're trying to exploit the weakness to try and steal something from you. But surprise, surprise, in the last two quarters, we're starting to notice a new trend. And because of the crazy pricing of Bitcoin, right? You are starting to see coin miners. And these are hackers that would go into your network, not just to steal information, but to stay with you for a very long time, abusing your infrastructure so that they can use it to do coin mining activities. So that is just really wicked, really, really wicked, because here they are, not only are they starting to steal your information, but they're going to be with you stealing and continuously bleeding your infrastructure. So here you are, you probably have applied to the government to get grants, to get some of the best computing environments in your country, only to find them being utilized and abused by these client miners. Now, you might think that, okay, this is just a PC problem, or this is just a Windows Mac problem, whatever have you. Why don't I move into a mobile device, a complete Android device or something like that? And even there, the sad fact is Android devices are not any better. And we have this classic example of the BlackRock Android malware, where it went in and it would install itself in your device, And from there, it would actually steal data over 377 from 377 apps, usually the passwords and so on. And then the hackers would take those and start going from there. So how does a hack happen? And here is a very rudimentary way. I mean, there are, by the way, much more sophisticated ways that I don't want to speak about because they would make you very queasy. But in a nutshell, any company, any organization must have some kind of web properties, and you'd basically be going in, and the web property might have something like, you know, upload your information here, contact us there, whatever have you. Any kind of entry point is an opportunity for me to start hacking you. And that's where I'll go in and upload my quote unquote suspicious image, whatever have you. And once it goes to your server, it opens back doors. And from there, I am having your whole system open to me. That's one way of doing it. The second way of doing it nowadays, given the COVID situation we're in, is that because you're using your laptops, your machines, your personal things, what I will do is that I will randomly sprinkle those pieces of malware on the internet, and I would basically install myself in your laptop, and I would only activate once the VPN connection is active. So that's where I can now start taking from your PC and going to your head office. So that is basically the problem in a nutshell. It's a really staggering problem because A, of the new way of we're doing work, B, because right now hackers are financially motivated, very, very well motivated, whether A, directly motivated to steal your data and hence asking you for ransom, or to stay with you, milking your infrastructure. So this is now where I start going into the science very quickly, and I'm going to show you why we do not believe existing technologies are sufficient. The classic way of protecting your system is using something called EDR, or an endpoint detection and remediation system. In a nutshell, these are basically the software you install in your PC. So for example, just to show you, I don't know if you can see my screen here, I have this thing, it's called Windows Security, it's Windows Defender. It comes with your PC. I have other EDRs installed on this PC. So think of these as programs that would analyze the network traffic coming to the PC and would try to stop bad things. The problem again is that these EDRs rely on signatures. And so they would be very good when it comes to non-malware, but they're quite useless when it comes to unknown malware. In addition to that, while I can install an EDR on my PC, I cannot install it, for example, on my printer. My printer does have a web interface that basically allows me to go in and manage my printing jobs, but I cannot install any kind of security on it. So that is basically opportunities where hackers go in and work around EDRs. Now, the second thing that we use is something called sandboxes, and I'm going to show you also why it doesn't work. Sandboxes are nothing more than emulation environments where if there is an unknown malware, I would send it out there. And look at this guy, sandboxes are not real time. So I'll give you an example here. The Cisco sandbox, for example, needs up to 3 minutes before it can determine whether this is known or unknown malware. And as a result of that, you have the malware in your network. This is a staggeringly bad example, right? It needs over 480 minutes, right? So if you do the math, that's over 4 hours, right? To determine your malware. So that is why we're having these hacks. And I'm going to basically just summarize it for you and then show you basically what can go wrong. This is classically how we protect our network nowadays. And the way we protect it is we have what's called the perimeter security. And usually that's a firewall. and I can have a sandbox connected with the firewall. And then on the endpoints, I have the EDRs if possible. So let us speak about that. And this is where I'm going to spend like a couple of minutes here going to show you what the problem is. The problem is the firewall is designed to do network translation. It's designed to basically sort of like block complete visibility of your network to the outside world. So a firewall would be given an external IP address, would have a lot of internal IP addresses, and that's what it's good at doing, hiding the details of your network. So that's what the firewall is supposed to do. Now, some firewalls do have signature scanning. So basically, they are able to match against signatures. And by the way, I'm going to give you an example of firewalls now. So the classic firewalls, the kings of the hills right now, are Cisco with their line of firewalls. You have the guys at Fortinet. You have the guys at Palo Alto. And so on. Now, if you're a telco, you'd probably be also be buying a Juniper firewall. Now, because firewalls are limited in trying to block malware, they rely on something called a sandbox. And a sandbox is nothing more than an emulation environment that tries to be emulating what could happen to your network if there's an unknown malware. So the way it works is that the session comes in, and if the firewall cannot determine if this session is completely clean or not, it will send it to the sandbox, right? So think of it coming in, it's like exactly like the passport system at the airport. You come in and they try to scan your passport. If they cannot figure you out, then there will be some, what we call as, you know, an extra screening where you go to a room and someone starts interrogating you. So that's exactly what happens here, is that the malware goes, the malware is coming in, the firewall cannot determine what's happening with it, it sends it to the sandbox. Now, in the sandbox, what we do is that we try to recreate your environment here. So basically, if you had Windows servers here, we basically try to put VMs of Windows servers here. If you have Linux servers here, we try to do the same and so on. And hence the first problem. Problem number one is that you will never be able to totally mimic the environment because you do have printers, you have card lock readers, you have camera systems and so on, all of which you cannot basically, you know, mimic in your sandbox. So that's problem number one, the sandbox. Problem number two is that even though sandboxes have artificial intelligence, they have what's called as behavioral artificial intelligence. And this is where I'm now going to go a bit further into technology, because I want to basically get you guys to appreciate that artificial intelligence is not the solution for all of our problems, right? You might basically be following newspapers here and there, and everyone is trying to paint to you the picture that AI is the savior. It's the knight with the shining armor coming to save us from our world problems. And it isn't. That's just a sad fact. It is not. Why? Because behavioral AI relies on the malware to exhibit behavioral issues or behavioral traits that are malicious. And the way you do it is you basically take that suspicious code or the suspicious file that was about to be sent to you, and you try to activate it in the sandbox. And you try to basically apply AI techniques to see whether the behavior of the environment inside the sandbox has changed, right? And again, hackers are not that stupid, right? I mean, we're speaking about hackers that could be paid handsomely. In fact, I always tell the kids I teach, I do, by the way, a lot of charity work as well on my Sundays where I go and teach our kids, you know, leadership and so on. And I always tell my kids, guys, don't be losers, don't do drugs, right? Because there's a lot more money in hacking than in drugs. And that's true, right? Hackers basically can be paid handsomely, like over $100,000 to write a piece of malware. And what I'm trying to show you here is that a hacker nowadays is designing their malware with the idea that it could be run in a sandbox. So how do you evade the sandbox? And that is the thing. You evade the sandbox by relying on the weakness of behavioral AI. What do I mean by that? Let me explain. Now, the malware is now in the sandbox, and it knows it's in a sandbox. And the way it knows it's in a sandbox is by doing a lot of techniques. First technique, it tries to scan the environment. And if it doesn't find that it's a real environment, because this is a virtualization environment, then that's one way. The second way is that sandboxes have to accelerate time. What do I mean by that? Because the main problem we have in malware is that the malware might come into your network, could behave nicely for a month or so. In some cases, could behave nicely for up to, say, years, actually. And then at a certain moment in time, it would activate and then start doing something bad to your network. So sandboxes have to do what's accelerating the time horizon, meaning that they would basically accelerate the clock. And so sandbox malwares are also now trained to do so. So in a nutshell, we have now, hackers have now used AI against AI, if you can see what I'm trying to say here. So I'm trying to see if this malware is going to activate or not. And so I accelerate the time. The malware itself is keeping track of time. So if it notices something funny with time, it would immediately deduce it's in a sandbox. So in a nutshell, that is how we protect ourselves nowadays. We have a firewall that uses signatures that's not sufficient because the problem is not old malware. The problem is new malware. We have a sandbox that's presumably here to help us discover what is happening because using behavioral AI and trying to discover whether this is going to be malicious or not. And as a result of that, I can actually trick it because I'm going to use the behavioral techniques against it. And then last but not least, I have the endpoint itself, which I spoke to you, having its own kind of techniques where it can do signatures again. And the result of which is usually I am anyway, sorry for excusing this word, doomed, right? This is how we protect our networks nowadays. These are the techniques we use, and that is why we are still having these outbreaks. We use signatures which are not good enough because they only protect us against non-malware. We use sandboxes which are A, not real time. They use behavioral AI, which I have just shown you or talked to you about how it could be evaded. And then we have the endpoint. So if you look at this, well, so what do we do, right? This is such a sad state of affairs. I mean, have hackers won the game? I mean, are we going to be living with this fact? Is it going to be a matter of you're going to basically get doomed regardless? What is the solution, right? And this is where I'm going to tell you that there is good news. The good news is we have solved this problem and we'll continue to solve it, but using two techniques. First of all, we don't believe in behavioral AI because I just mentioned to you, it's like someone coming in for a job interview and having the putting on the best face in the job interview, but at reality is not that good. So we use what's called a static code analysis. And the second thing in addition to that, to do all of this real time. So this is where I'm going to basically now move into the solution, the research I'm doing, into how I solve this problem. But before I do so, do you have any questions for me? Any question?
Probably take all the questions at the end, Dr. Hussein. So
okay. Sure. So our products basically, or our approach to solving security is basically to do the water filter analogy, right? I mean, remember, I grew up in Africa, so water is such an important thing in life. I mean, using a lot of it here this morning too. And the analogy is this: you basically have the network traffic go through our solution, and from there we basically stop any kind of malware. So I'm going to basically show you how we do it. I'm not going to show you the importance of that, but this is how we do it in a nutshell. I'm just going to go through this. We have four techniques that we had to develop to do so. The first technique is that we recognize that the existing packet inspection technologies are no longer sufficient. And packet inspection technologies is exactly like me crossing through the airport. So let us say I'm trying to cross the airport at say again, Karachi or Islamabad, and I'm bringing a gun in my luggage, okay? So here I am, I'm gonna put my bag on the conveyor belt, and the guy is gonna see the gun in my luggage because it got scanned by X-ray. And then of course, the guy is gonna tell me, what's wrong with you, Hussam? Why are you bringing a gun to Pakistan? And I'm gonna have a very rough time and I'm gonna regret doing so. So that is deep packet inspection. Deep packet inspection, the way we do it, guys, through hardware, is as the packets are coming through, we have basically network buffers. We store those packets in the network buffers. We use what's called as XOR technology, which is basically I have similar circuits below it, and using flip-flops or whatever have you, I do a quick comparison, a quick XOR comparison, two signatures. So the good news is if the malware or if the gun in the bag is in that bag, then you'd immediately see it. So basically, deep packet inspection technologies would work and would work very well as long as the scope of scanning is the scope where the malware is. If basically it so happens that the scope of scanning is not within, then you're doomed. So what do I mean by that? Let us basically take the other example. Hussam now decided to become really, really evil. He hired three of his friends, and Hussam and his friends are coming into the airport. And this time, they're not going to put guns in their luggage. They're going to do the following. They're going to take their guns. First of all, have it 3D printed, so it's plastic. It's not made of metal. That's one thing. And secondly, they're going to break up the gun into pieces. Right? So Sam would take some pieces, his friend would take some other pieces, and guess what's going to happen? We are going to pass through security and no one would be able to stop us at all. And the reason that's the case is because the scanning right now cannot see a gun, right? It sees pieces, but it doesn't have the smarts of assembling those pieces. And unfortunately, hackers are evil, and that's how they think. They think of how to hack the system. They're thinking of how to evade you. And so this is where I'm really going to make you really, really, really worried, right? A hacker is a person who has extreme intelligence, extremely smart people, right? I meet with them, I see them. They are very scary people. They have amazing brains. God gave them amazing, amazing intelligence. But this intelligence is not in the right place. It's in the place of how to hack things. So that's one way of hacking, right? I basically break up the malware into pieces that the existing systems will not see it. And that is the problem of deep packet inspection. Deep packet inspection only inspects at the packet level. And that technique, by the way, of deep packet inspection was invented by Checkpoint, a company based in Israel many, many years ago. And the guy who invented it is a guy called Nir Zuk, right? Nir Zuk basically was a new hire hired by Checkpoint. He and the founder of Checkpoint had a big fight. So he left Checkpoint. He went and formed a company called NetScreen. And NetScreen was acquired by Juniper. He still did not have the chance to embed, to completely develop his vision. So he went and founded Palo Alto, which is actually one of the world's largest security companies. And until this moment, we are all using deep packet inspection. And as I've just mentioned to you, deep packet inspection is very good if the scope of scanning would see the malware. If it is not, then you're doomed. So that's what we did. We went in, and the first way to solve the problem is we invented something called deep content inspection. And if you do a Google, patents.google.com with my name, you'd find that invention. So that was the first thing we did, is to be able to reconstruct the payload in real time before it goes to your endpoint. What do I mean by that? Imagine a scanning technique at the airport where I'm going to say, okay, all passengers heading to say flight 500 to Delhi or whatever it is, right? I'm going to take all of their bags. I'm going to basically take all of their bags and start taking out all of their bags and reconstructing anything there in their bags, right? And that's exactly what we do at the network layer. We do this deep content inspection where we get to reconstruct the packets into the objects that are going to be delivered to your endpoint. So think of it as follows. Here are the packets coming in. I have my system coming in here in the middle. I'm reconstructing things in real time. So I get to see objects. I get to see the PDFs. I get to see the Excel files, the Word files, everything that are about to be delivered to your endpoint. So that was point number one of solving the problem. We call it divisibility problem, right? So you have to basically have visibility, right? And trust me, guys, in any problem, if you're trying to solve the problem, there is no point solving the problem if you don't have visibility. You must have visibility. Otherwise, your solution would be useless. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is that we recognize that security has to be real time. And whether we like it or not, we're speaking about gigs of traffic. We're speaking about tons of traffic coming in and coming out. I cannot suddenly basically say, I'm going to stop everything, because the world does not work this way. So point number two that we solved is, how can we continuously scan traffic as going through your network? And that's exactly what we do. For those who are technicians in the audience, as you know, the TCP handshake, there is basically SYN and ACKS. Basically, think of it, you send a piece, you acknowledge it, and so on. So what we're doing is we are latching on it. We're continuously scanning as the payload is going through your network. So that's point number two, is for a solution to be useful, you cannot say, and I'm saying this to all of the scientists in the room, and I do apologize if I offend you, but this is a reality. To be a useful solution, you must comply with the nature of what you have. You must have your solution fit what you are solving. Otherwise, the solution against is going to be useless. So visibility and fit is the second one. So that's the two things we did here. So how can we make our solutions real time? Now, the third thing is this, is that you also have to recognize that we are solving a problem where malware could be completely unknown, completely brand new. Someone could have basically hired people to write a malware to cripple your organization, your defense, your whatever have you. And this is a reality. Now we're having malware that's completely tailored for you. It's basically tailored to cripple your organization, and it's no longer, oh, let us be peaceful. No, you got to basically understand that this is a war. This is a vicious war, right? And people who don't have the technology, who don't have the willingness to solve the problem, will be crippled. That's just a fact of life in cybersecurity. So how do we do it? Remember I talked to you about behavioral AI, where we basically run the thing and try to discover it. Unfortunately, that is where we are in the industry, right? There are only three companies in the industry right now that I personally respect their AI techniques. And these companies are Deep Instinct, which is an Israeli company, Silence, which was an American company and became a Canadian company, and CrowdStrike. These companies have, you know, we with them, we share the same approach, but we share it differently. Basically that you cannot do behavioral AI, you have to do code analysis AI. So the way we do it is this, we basically take a lot of malware samples. We take over 600 million samples and continuously increasing, and we train a neural network. A neural network is like training a child, right? A neural network is a computer that, instead of writing code to program it, where you say, do this, do this, do this, you basically have what we call a state, finite state machines. And in these finite state machines, it basically has to have inputs to make a deduction, right? And so what we do here is we train it like train a child, and we do the two types of training, the supervised and unsupervised. What do I mean by that? It's exactly like training a child. If I'm trying to train my child, for example, on how to detect birds when she's going out for a hike, I'll basically tell her a bird has these features, feathers, beaks, you know, wings, and so on. And so as a result of that, in her head, she's starting to understand what a bird is. Now, this supervised training is not sufficient simply because you are not giving the child a way to think of how to use these features. So we do what's called the thing that most of us hated as students, but the more I went to the science, I can understand why, is to have homework, right? Homework is where you give the child the exercise. Most important thing is that you as a parent should not intervene and help your kid with the homework, right? You have to let them do it on their own. And that is where in the unsupervised learning, the neural network starts to discover other features that we never spoke about. So as a result of that, in our neural network, right, what we have a neural network that has over 3.6 quadrillion data points that's able to discover malware based on its features rather than its signatures. A feature is a hallmark. It's like a DNA, right? This piece of code that changes the registry, this piece of code that does that, and so on. And based on that, we have a neural network that's trained to discover up to 6.8 million features. And the fun part is we have spent a lot of time figuring out how to do this in real time. So think of it, malware comes in, it goes through the neural network, and poof, in less than 10 milliseconds, we are able to determine whether this is malware or not, right? And that is our innovation, being able to do so in real time. So in a nutshell, basically, this is how we do it, just very quickly, so that you guys appreciate it. We do the deep packet inspection. That's one thing we do. We also do signature analysis, because it's very important to weed out the non-terrorists, right? And then in the last phase, what we do is we do the AI techniques, and our AI techniques are not behavioral, but static code analysis, right? And then we do recognize in training, we have to continuously train our engines. So that's what we do, where we have a training module that is continuously watching the verdicts. And if it sees some kind of deviation, it does that. The beauty is that now I can stand up in front of you and say, I do believe that we as humanity, we do have a chance of solving this problem of unknown malware in real time because of this innovation. But again, to wrap it up, guys, I always want you to remember, there is no point solving a problem if you don't have visibility. If you have visibility, if you have a very good understanding of the problem, then chances of success are extremely high. But then the second thing is that you need to have your solution, right, to be in line with the problem. Do not come up with two solutions. They will not fly, they will not work. Make sure that your solution is in line with the problem. Do not try to imagine what I call a spherical chaos, right? Imagine a problem that you have, solve it, and that would be my last parting words for you. And Dr. Hatem, go ahead, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hussein. But I'd like if you could show them a demo very quick, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. Why not? Okay, so here I am, guys, and let me start showing you. Okay, here I am. Okay, sure, why not? Let's do that. Here I am, and first thing I did is showing you what's my IP. And my IP address is in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. My ISP is Shaw Communications. Now, I'm right now, without my technology in line, I'm completely, frankly speaking, naked, because my endpoint solution, the EDR I have on my endpoint, is not good enough anyway. I mean, like, I don't believe in EDR. So this is where I am this morning. I'm now going to get myself secured. So the way I'm going to do it is that I'm going to connect to our VPN. And this VPN connects me to technology running in Azure. Azure, as you know, is Microsoft cloud provider. So now everything is running through Azure. So can you see me, guys? Can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Good. Okay. Now let me see what's my IP address. And you're going to notice some latency because I'm going now all the way to Toronto. So my traffic is going from Calgary to Toronto. And by the way, the distance between Calgary and Toronto is 4 hours by plane, 4 hours by plane, right? So that's how big Canada is. It's so huge, right? So now all of my traffic is going to Toronto. Now, what does this mean? It means that, you know, I'm having my technology inspect every single bit and byte of my traffic. So here we go. I'm going to go in and start showing you the efficacy of my technology. Here is, for example, some kind of malware, right? So these are double zip malware. I'm going to click on them, right? And basically, poof, in real time, it just stopped it. So now I'm protected real time. And that's the advantage we have. Now, don't get me wrong. I have some of the worst malwares out there. So people like to collect things, right? Because I'm in the business of malware. I have to collect some of the worst out there. So this is, by the way, some of the worst pieces of malware I've ever seen in my life, that I've collected them. And I'm going to show you how the real-time AI is working. So I'm going to click on one of those. And in real time, the AI engine stopped it, right? Nothing very fancy, but at least I know that this piece of malware did not come through. I can also show you some of the legacy malwares, like, for example, ransomwares and so on. And by the way, I would never do what I'm showing you here, guys, if I don't have my technology in line. So this, I think, was a ransomware, right? Let me just click on it. And here it is. This was a suspicious document. Sorry. I'm going to show you something nice, right? I'm playing with fire now, guys. You should never do this without my technology in line. Here I am basically trying to visit really bad pieces of malware, right? And here it is. This was a poly ransomware. If I had basically did not have my technology in line, This machine would have been gone like in 50 seconds. Now, the most important thing, again, about any innovation, and thank you so much, Dr. Hatem, for asking me to do this, is showing the results of what you have done. Because see, if you don't show what you have done, no one cares anyway, right? We always have this saying, if the tree falls in the forest, does anyone hear it, right? So this is the thing, you have to show your innovation. And the way we do this, by the way, is using some really killer user interfaces to show the company the value of our solution. What did we do that's valuable? So here it is, by the way, this is the dashboard of my technology. And this is the dashboard of my company's product running to protect it. And as you can see here, ladies and gentlemen, I'm showing you what we have stopped in the last 24 hours. Because our company is a vendor, we're always under constant attack. And so basically here are points that are attacking my network. And here are the internal points, right? And this is my product. We call it the shield protecting me. Now, as you can see here on the right-hand side, I'm showing you the type of attacks that then the product stopped. So this is the packet-based attacks. And this goes to show you that packet-based approaches are really gone. And that's why all of the technologies we have nowadays are really useless, right? Because as you can see in the last hour, we stopped only 5 of those. And this is basically attacks we stopped using signatures. So we stopped 94. But these ones are the real vicious ones. These are the attacks we stopped that there are no signatures for, completely brand new, and they're just coming and attacking us. And as you can see, these are the source of attacks. The ones that really follow are the ones that our AI engine stopped. So this is basically some of those attacks, and I'm gonna drill down from here. So it shows you that these are the attacking points. This happens to be on our servers. So I'm gonna go in and look at the attacks in depth. This IP address is an IP address that I personally recognize now just by looking at it every day in and day out. And this IP address happens to be from the Friendly Republic of Iran, right? The Friendly Republic of Iran has been developing some of the world's worst malicious stuff, and we are being bombarded by them every day. So this guy's basically, I'm going to show you this malware that we stopped. And this is the AI engine giving me its results. The AI engine is giving me the results based on the features that I told you about. So it's telling me that this malware, had it had a chance to operate into my network, luckily that's not the case because of my technology, is that it would have collected information, it would have used deception, and would have used destruction. Now, looking at these features, guys, there is no hesitation when I'm going to make the statement that I'm 100% sure that this malware was written by an expert. Why? Because look at what it's trying to do. It's trying to collect information, which tells me that this piece of malware was designed to be what we call like the paratroopers of the army, right? You drop them behind the enemy lines and get them to discover what is behind the enemy line. So that's the first thing. It tries to do collection. And what kind of information is it interested in? It's interested in only structured information, meaning information that would allow me to launch other attacks. So it's trying to find the type of operating systems in the network and the type of file types. So that's the first one. The second one is going to try to do deception techniques, because if you send a paratrooper behind the enemy line, well, guess what? They have to be hidden. And so that's what it's trying to do. It's trying to store itself as temporary files to avoid detection. But get this, this is why in my mind, this is 100% a very well-written piece of malware, is that it has destruction techniques. If it's about to be discovered, guess what it tries to do? First of all, it will try to create noise, a distraction technique. What does it do? It basically spawns off a lot of processes. So your operating system is crippled. It can no longer defend itself. Why? And then it will go in and delete and wipe its traces. So very, 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 very sophisticated piece of malware that comes to us from the Friendly Republic of Iran. And we were able to stop it in real time before it made it to the network and has the beauty of the technology. Now, in addition to that, remember, guys, you know, as an inventor, if technology, you just cannot speak about things. For people who are analysts in the field, right, I also have an archive of these bad things. So whenever I stop a bad piece of malware, I also store a copy so that the analysts in the field can go and play with them and try to prove that. So this is basically actual malware there and then. Right. So basically, this is it in a nutshell. Right. What we do here is we provide a product that not only is it very effective in how it stops things, but also very critically, it has to show the value to the end user. Right. And by the way, that's innovation. And that's how it should be. You need to show and demonstrate the value of what you have done. Otherwise, no one would believe you. And here it is, ladies and gentlemen, right? How we stop malware in real time, because it's the biggest problem we have. How we also demonstrate it. But more importantly, guys, an innovation has to be simple. And by the way, I subscribe to the Japanese philosophy, which is called Shibumi. It's called effortless perfection. Perfection has to be so effortless. The innovation has to be so simple, right? Innovations that are not simple are not innovations, in my humble opinion. They have to be so simple to deploy, so easy to show the value for, and that's the last that I can say. There you go, Dr. Harun.